So to this wicked union of Ahab and Jezebel, they had a child by the name of Athaliah. And Athaliah was the seed that was promised to King Jehoshaphat's son, Jehoram. And Jehoram was the king of Judah. Now, in Judah, they're still serving and worshiping God. And as a result of this union, Athaliah becomes the queen of the northern kingdom of Israel. So she comes from an evil descent. She also has an evil and wicked heart. And even her mother was equated to witchcraft, even in the scripture. Witchcraft and rebelliousness against the things of God. Rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft. Anytime that anyone wields, listen, such influence to cause to change someone's position that they have long time been walking in, such as in the case of Ahab, turning his heart away from serving the true God and to idolatry, as well as all of the inhabitants of the northern kingdom. That is a strong spirit of influence. That influence is purely wicked in nature. And one thing about witchcraft and witches and those that practice sorcery, they come with a strong spirit to be able to cause to change and to deceive and cause those that are under their care or seeking advice from them to be strongly influenced by demonic spirits. Listen to me. That's why people don't know what they're getting, becoming associated with. Strong spirits, demonic spirits. And those spirits don't stop normally at that particular generation. Once a person has made that their practice, then they continue it and they will that, or they actually communicate that down to their seed after them. So in this child, Athaliah, understand this, that there were spirits assigned to her life. And one of the things that I've been praying about, because sometimes we're ignorant, listen, to things that are transpiring in our lives. Jezebel was killed by the word of Elijah when he sent words and asked, who was on my side, when he sent the one that he anointed, Jehud, back. And he said that whoever is on my side, throw her down from the wall. And the scriptures say that she, the eunuchs, threw her down after she had made herself up, Jezebel we're speaking of, and the dogs ate her. That only thing was left was her hands and her feet, so that no one could even recognize or understood that she was thrown down because of her rebelliousness, which was the word of the Lord concerning her. And we have to be careful about the sea, because sometimes there are things happening in our lives that have come from the generations prior to us, which is called a generational curse. Something that your forefathers lived in, a spirit of influence that was over them, that was passed down to the fourth and the fifth and so on, generations after them. And sometimes you have to ask yourself, where have these things come from? Over the past few weeks, I've been sitting down and doing some introspection, some serious reflections over my life personally, and over my parents' life, and even looking at my children's lives. And I could see some things that was passed down through the generations on both sides. And there's things that I have successfully identified and have begun to pray against those things, that those spirits and those generational curses will be broken and will no longer have any influence over my generation and over my seed, or even over my life or the things that will continue. Just because you've reached a certain point in your life, just because you may be walking in ministry, just because you're saved, doesn't necessarily mean that every generational curse has been broken and destroyed over your life. And many of us are still wrestling and struggling with things that were passed down to us from our parents and our parents' parents. And we're not sure why our quality of life has suffered the way that it has. Maybe you need to sit quietly, look at the things and the influence and how negatively different things have impacted your life. Sometimes it's because sometimes the enemy isolates you because there was a spirit of introversion over your family. Sometimes there was a spirit of depression over your family. Sometimes there were financial curses that were spoken over your family. Sometimes there are racial issues that were passed down from generations that are still impacting your family. Sometimes there is bitterness and anger between siblings and aunts and uncles and family members that are still continuing, causing a family feud. Why? Because it's a generational curse. There are things that causes you not to be able to get along with other people because it's a generational curse. Sometimes it seems there's failure after failure because there is a generational curse. And those generational curses, until they are divinely broken by God, will continue perpetually and will continue unchecked until you gain enough strength and fortitude to sit down and recognize it by the Spirit of the living God, and to fast and to pray and ask God Himself to break these spirits over your life so that they would no longer follow you, that they would no longer inhibit your quality of life and your progression in Him, until He can finally break and destroy and defeat the enemy. The enemy will always have an upper hand on you, but it's your turn to break, listen, the back of the enemy over your life and over your seed's life and over your children's life. You can command the generational curses to be broken. But let's follow Athaliah, because Athaliah had a generational curse. She was an innocent child born to wicked parents. Listen, born to wicked parents. And because of their gross wickedness and her being raised around that gross wickedness, her being raised around the worship of Baal, her being raised around a murderous, conniving woman who was very influential to her and probably even instructed Athaliah in the ways of wickedness to the point that she became astute at it. She became keen at it. She began to show a sort of intellectual advancement towards these things, because this is what she was instructed in. And a child, the Bible says that we're to train up a child in the way that they should go, and when they're old, they shall not depart from it. That's why it's very paramount that we raise our children in the fear and the admonition of the Lord. Because if we raise them any other way, then it will be a hard time and a task for either you or someone else after you to teach them what is right in the eyesight of the Lord. And God Himself will have to break down their belief systems to get them to understand what the truth really is, and show them what they believed in the past was false. It can be done, and it can be done through the Spirit of the living God, by someone who is anointed and by God Himself to open up their understanding, to show them the light of His truth, and that He is the true and the living God, and besides Him there is no other. And Athaliah was pretty much the same as her mother. The scriptures say her son was by the name of Ahaziah, who became king in his father's stead at the age of 22. And during the course of his reign, his mother politically influenced him throughout the course of his reign. Now, this was the embodiment of a mama's boy. Now, let's deal with that for just a few moments. Because some of us men, talking to the men now, and to you mothers, some of us men are mama's boys. We don't know how to cut the apron strings loose when it's time to grow up and be a man. We don't know how to stand up as a man. We're still fully reliant on mom. And mom is still fully reliant on her son, which causes an unnatural soul tie. And even if that man were to have a significant other in his life, female, and was to marry her, or even in that relationship, that female would play havoc because she would find that this boy of a man is greatly influenced still by his mother. Women, mothers, you must allow a man to grow up and experience life on his own. You must allow him to make his mistakes. You must allow him to make his decisions. You must be there for him to help and guide him through it, but never once influencing to the point that he sees you as the sole source. Even when he gets married, he must be willing to cut loose the apron string. That's why the Bible says in Genesis, which I often allude to, therefore shall a man leave his father and mother, come out from under your parents' covering. Come out from under your father's authority. Come out from under your mother's nurturing and caring. Stop running back to mama every time that you make a boo-boo and a failure and you fall. Sometimes you have to learn to get up, dust yourself off, make proper decisions, not depending upon someone else, but making proper decisions to move forward to improve the quality of your life and that of your family. Some of you that have husbands that are acting like a mama's boy, you are not his mother. You're not his mother. You can't tell him what to do. He has a mind of his own. Yes, it may not be the mind that you want him to have, but the main thing that you need to do is pray. So as Ahaziah, his ministry was great, or his kingship was greatly influenced by his mother. So here you see, he only reigned for a year and was ultimately wounded in battle and later died of his wounds. And as a result of him dying, there were 70 princes that were prince that were supposed to be able to assume the throne. But when Athaliah heard that her son had died, and that certain things had transpired in Israel, the scriptures say that she arose and she killed all the seed royal, all the potential heirs to the throne. She now killed them. You see how this murderous spirit was over her mother, Jezebel. Now this murderous spirit has been communicated down to her daughter. And both of them acted upon the impulses. Listen, the foreign, ungodly impulses that were put in them because of an evilness. Because either something was taken away from them, or they could not gain an advantage over certain things. So therefore, they took it in their own hands to act and bring about a result that they thought was favorable through the spirit and the committing of a crime of murder. In this case, Athaliah killed 70 of the seed royal. So Athaliah's purpose is also to kill the kingly anointing and the potentiality of assuming the rightful throne of authority that God would choose for you as his seed to be seated upon. The Bible says that we are a peculiar people, a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, that we might show forth the praises of him who has called us out of darkness and into his marvelous life.